Briefly, I'll just give an introduction on what we do at IFC, jump right into PPPs, and I thought, you know, let's debunk some of the myths about PPPs, look at it more conceptually and looking at sub-Saharan Africa and what's been going on in the PPP space, and then just kind of give you an ed memoir or a checklist for policymakers if you're going to launch into the shark-infested waters of PPPs, but more seriously if you want to get involved in that space. So IFC is part of the World Bank Group. I think IFC is known more for its lending window. I come from the advisory side, and we'll advise governments on structuring and implementing PPPs. But the general remit of IFC, whether it's advisory or lending, is really to enhance and promote private sector development in our member countries. And the group that I work for, we act as a transaction advisor, advising governments on PPPs. We work right across the globe. And in Africa, we've got hubs in Dakar, Nairobi, and Johannesburg. So I come from the Dakar office. So I thought, you know, I didn't know what to call this. You know, don't believe the hype. If you go to the next slide. You know, when we talk about infrastructure development and look at both total space of public service provision, you know, PPPs is just one project delivery option. If you look at most governments around the world, it could represent anywhere from 10 to 50% of government spend. So it is not the option. And I think the point to be made here is you should be very selective when it comes to choosing the path of PPPs. It's not the answer for every country, every sector, and every project. So what is a PPP? This part I love because everyone's got their definition. I think four people, five definitions is usually what you come out of that kind of debate. So it's not one size fits all. It has to be bespoke and specific to the project, the country, and the sector. It's obviously not for free. There's a cost attached to it. It is not 100% private finance. I remember when PPPs were sort of brought to the fore in Africa in the 90s, it was probably oversold to think that the private sector would come in, government can sit back, they'll take on all the investments, and in fact the reality was actually quite different. It's not privatization. You know, the most popular form of PPP that's often touted is a concession where the state remains the asset owner. Assets can be owned by the concessionaire, but the core assets like a railway track infrastructure typically remains the property of the state. And PPP is about risk transfer. In fact, I think that's one of the key components of a PPP, how you allocate the risks on a particular project. It's very difficult politically, as I'm sure all of us here know, when it comes to implementing a PPP. It's very complex. I've got a slide that's going to come up just to show you how complex a PPP project structure can be. And it's also very beneficial. I'm perhaps a bit biased in this regard. I know there's been a lot of difficult press when it comes to PPPs. Just look at rail concessioning in Africa, a very mixed record. But if you follow certain conditions, if it's implemented in what we can call the right way, and we can argue what the right way actually means, it actually is quite beneficial. So it's complex. I mean, this is just one example of how you would project finance a project. In fact, project finance is often termed contract finance because all of those lines to the project company are tied to contracts and how you're allocating the risk and pushing it from the project company to the various players, be it insurance companies, contractors, etc. So it just shows you that, you know, you can't go into a PPP project lightly. You've really got to have the right expertise and selected the project carefully. Now, if you look at the benefits, again, one can argue just how beneficial PPPs can be, but if you look at one of the more sophisticated markets in PPPs, and you look at the UK PFI market, they've got a national audit office that's quite good at tracking PPPs every year by auditing the projects that have gone through the pipeline. And if you look at the benefits, it's maybe hard to read, but they say that under a PPP project, about 80% are on time and on budget, whereas conventional procurement, that rate actually goes down to 30%. And that's fairly well been tracked for well over 10 years. On the next slide, again, probably difficult to read. The point being made here is if you look at the axis, and it's actually very hard to read, in fact, even it's hard for me to read, but on the left axis, you're looking at the total whole, sort of whole life cycle cost of a PPP, and then you've got time on the bottom axis. And the point being made here is that if you wait at the tail end of a project, so the gates show you the different stages in the project, so gate zero is really the initial stage of the strategic development of a project, and the latter stages are when the contract is actually in play and you're looking at the benefits. if you focus on influencing project outcome at the tail end of that project cycle, you're really looking at a minimal impact in terms of the whole life cycle cost of a project. But if at the tail end, at the beginning, in terms of looking at the strategy, the justification, and the actual procurement, if you can get as much of those elements right early on, obviously the benefit is much higher. So maybe I'm stating the obvious, I mean, it could be common sense, but the number of projects in which I've been involved and things like regulation, etc., don't come in at the beginning of a project. They actually come at the tail end. You're not generating the full benefit of those very positive reforms in implementing a PPP. So the PPP or not a PPP? It's a difficult question. What we often tell our clients is stop, think about it. You know, don't jump into a PPP. It's not, in fact, the solution for any project. So if you're looking at the policy objectives, it's really critical what are the drivers. If you look at PPPs in the 90s, unfortunately, they were very much part of structural adjustment. So a lot of the clients that I worked with in the 90s actually didn't believe in the PPP. And really, that was a setup for failure rather than success. Institutional capabilities are quite important. You often hear this term of a project champion. It's maybe become a bit cliche, but it's critical. If you don't have a clear champion behind a project, the chances for its failure are actually quite high. And the procurement governance, quite critical. If you want to gain credibility with potential bidders, they want to make sure that there's a transparent bidding process in front of them. If there's too much uncertainty, you're actually going to scare away some very attractive private sector players. The PPP model, the risk transfer, we've already talked about briefly, that's quite critical to get that risk transfer right. Risk equals cost. You know, so that's quite critical in designing the PPP. It will never disappear. You're simply shifting it from perhaps government taking it on versus a private sector player. And what's interesting is if you look at the value for money equation that's often brought up, especially the UK PFI projects, Australia, they really push value for money. The real benefit that you capture in going from public sector to private sector is that if it's public sector, you know, without giving you a number, risk is this much. So I'm sort of, you know, my hands are this far apart. Whereas if it's private sector, the risk is reduced to maybe half of that or three quarters of that. And that typically is the real benefit you're getting from a PPP. So you need to get that transfer right as much as possible. Private finance actually comes at a cost. So if you can't reduce those risks, those uncertainties, all you're doing is adding a risk premium to a project. So it really behooves a government to ensure that the risks are diminished as much as possible, at least the ones that they can control. Financial capabilities. We've heard a lot of, you know, rail interconnection projects in West Central Africa. I pick on rail because it's a sector that's sort of close to my heart. And I sort of question why governments might want to spend $2 billion for brand new rail when rehabilitating existing infrastructure might only cost $200 to $300 million. That's just a number pulled from the air. So really look at the capabilities of what a government can actually afford. The legal regulatory environment, again, absolutely critical to make sure that the sector is has the right tariff structures in place or has a regulator in place if that's necessary. And then the country context is really critical to ensure that you're going to attract an investor-friendly, it's investor-friendly to attract the right investors. So if you look at PPPs in sub-Saharan Africa, again, not that terribly easy to read, but if you look at the trend, the graph shows the number of new infrastructure projects from 1990 to 2009. You can see that it's increased steadily through the 90s, tapered off through the recession period in the early 2000s, climbed again thanks to, in large part, to transport infrastructure projects in sort of the mid-2000s, and then really has tapered off in the last 5 to 6 years. And that just shows you that the market, as far as I'm concerned, is underperforming in terms of the number of projects. In overall commitments, you're looking at probably about 50, and this is the PPI database managed by the World Bank, you're looking at about $50 billion of investments in the last 10 years, rather the last 9 years. Sub-Saharan Africa, unfortunately, only accounts for about 10% of the activity in developing countries by number of projects, and around the same rate when it comes to investment. And if you look at where that's concentrated, Nigeria and South Africa account for at least a quarter of that. So you can see that really there's a lot more that needs to be done in this space. And the needs are substantial. If you look at different statistics, this one is pulled from actually from UNICA, as well as work done by UBS. So if you look at the density in index for infrastructure, you can see that Africa sorely lags behind developing countries as well as the developed countries. Power is, and this is what we'll be talking about for the next 2 days, is in particular need of these investments. I'll just jump to the next one. So what proportion can be privately financed? The AICD report, which was cited earlier, says that power, whether you're looking at capital investment or O&M requirements, is really in dire need of funding. What was actually surprising from the AICD report was the extent of existing public sector funding. It actually surprised me. So there already is significant investment, but for that funding gap, and they say the annual requirement depends what numbers you want to believe, but if it's $93 billion according to the AICD report, the spend is about half of that. So there's a huge gap that needs to be closed. And if you look at the investments that have already been invested in Africa, the range, according to AICD, is about 7.5 to 8 billion, and according to the PPI database, about 12 to 13 billion per annum, but still falls short of what's required. So now I thought the next slides, sorry, it's so far away, so it's hard to read, but I thought I'd just look at some trends over the last 5 years. So this looks at the number of projects according to the different types of PPI. So you can see that concessioning, although very popular 5 years ago, in fact accounts for a lesser proportion of the types of PPI. Greenfield projects are the ascendancy, and then you've got divestitures and management contracts behind that. The next slide. Here focuses on total investment commitment to investment projects in the last 5 years. So you can see that energy and telecom sort of accounted for most of the new projects, water and sewage falling behind. Transport, again, in 2005, quite high, but in the last few years has tapered off. And I think this is the most instructive slide of all. Telecoms have accounted, if you just look at 2009, it accounted for 96% of regional investments. If you look at the trend in the last 10 years, it's 76%. The other ones, if you can read them, energy in the last 10 years only accounted for 10%. Transport accounted for 14%. So you can really see there's an imbalance when it comes to where the investments are directed. So the last slide is really just a reminder of what a policymaker could look at when looking at a PPP. One is really to evaluate whether this is the best route to follow, given its complexity. Looking at the existing framework and seeing which reforms are necessary. I had a chat with Clive before this started, and looking at the capability of the existing utility, looking at the regulatory environment, really is your first step before just launching into a PPP. I think having a national infrastructure strategy is quite critical as well, because if you're going to look at rail infrastructure development, power development, port development, they're all tied together. They shouldn't be looked at in isolation, especially in areas of like utilities. The reforms really need a strong champion. Looking at financial resources obviously will have an impact on which PPP projects you would select. Transparent procurement guidelines, absolutely critical. Having an in-house team that's dedicated to the project but also has the right experience is also important. It's a bit of self-promotion, but having good advisors in place who have got the right experience is also key as well. Engaging stakeholders, getting the right momentum is also quite important. If you don't do that, you could be alienating key stakeholders to the process. When it comes to the Doing Business Guide, which the World Bank puts out, one can argue about the methodology, but one should certainly want to race to the top of those rankings to create an investment-friendly climate. And then communicate, whether it's internally, how you can communicate with your own stakeholders, and even externally. With the rest of the world as you try to attract that investment is really quite critical. So I think I'll end it there, and thank you very much for your attention.